Hey there, folks, and welcome to another episode of ASP.NET Core from Zero to Overkill. This episode will be mostly about dependency injection. I've touched the topic briefly in the past episode and maybe in the one of the first ones, but today I'm going to get a little bit deeper, not tremendously, because using it is not that hard, but yeah. I think that this will be more focused. As an excuse to talk about dependency injection, we'll use this logic, if we can call it that, that's currently on the controller, and extract it to a service, because the controller should be as much as possible dumb. So it's just a way for us to get the HTTP requests. And then we should pass it along to a business layer that handles the logic for those requests. There are lots of ways of doing so. I will go with the simpler one by creating a service and using dependency injection to get that service to the controller. So let's start with creating a couple of projects. So new project. I'll be making a class library, and it will be so this will be the business library. In this case, this will be like where the contracts of the business will be created. So let's create this. I've failed to show you, but it's a .NET standard library, so it can be imported by different types of applications like .NET framework 4.7 something or 4.6.2, .NET Core from 2.0 above. In this case, because it's part of the project of the web application, it could be just .NET Core 2.1, but .NET Standard is the way to go for libraries, I think. So let's delete this class that comes by default. And we'll create a folder for services. So we want a service to handle this group logic. So let's create an interface, iGroups service. And of course, we would need the equivalent to these models. So I'll create a folder for the models, and in here create a new class that will represent a group, and I'll put here exactly the same. So copy paste, okay, so in the group service we want the same operations that the controller is implementing right now. So we want get all, get by ID, an update, and an add. So group service, we want, a rolling collection of groups. Why an iRead-only collection? Because iEnumerable would work, but the problem with iEnumerable is it may be lazily evaluated, and with iRead-only collection we guarantee that what we return is already evaluated, and there will be no problems like doing the same operations on the iEnumerable and causing the iEnumerable to be recomputed all the time. With our read-only collection, we return the thing already prepared. That's why I used, and being read-only instead of returning a list or an array, it's read-only, so it's immutable. And when doing these kinds of things, it's always better to try to make everything immutable. So if you have heard some things about functional programming, one of the key aspects is being immutable to simplify concurrency and make sure something that you give to another operation doesn't change what you have. In this case, the group is not immutable. It should, but this is a conscious decision to be simpler. We're implementing this right now. In the future, as we build on the application, it will eventually be made immutable. But for now, just to ease these initial developments, it will be mutable. So a collection, so we want get all, nothing else. We want get by ID, so it will return one group. We want an update. And we want a create or an add. Okay, so this is the interface for our service. With this interface, we can just start using it in the application. So let me add a reference to the project. Okay. So we can just go to the, for starters, I'll just delete this demo because I won't be using it anymore. Now we'll have errors. We don't want this, nor this. So let me just delete this. And we want an iGroup service. To simplify, iGroup service, group service. Okay. So we're injecting this, or declaring we want it to be inject, not yet, we don't have it. So we can use it right here. So we want group service dot get all. And now we see something that we want a group view model, but the get all is returning, of course, a group. There are lots of strategies. We can just do like right here a select and transform everything. We could use AutoMapper. In this case, I'll just create some utility functions to help here. It's a nice idea. A colleague had on another project and I liked it and I use it. So we create like a folder called mappings. And in here, I'll create a class group mappings. I'll make it static because I will be putting here extension methods. And over here, what we'll do will be public static group view model. Call it to view model. And it will receive the disease because it's an extension method, of course. So it will receive a group. This group. Okay, we have a group. So now we can do just return group. It's not null. new group view model. We want an ID equals group.id and a name. This is kind of boring code, but we need this mapping. Else, no. Now let's. Whoops. Okay, one line. It's not that big. Can be. So if the group is not null, we create a new one, a new view model. Else, null. Now we'll do basically the opposite. So let me just rename this to model. It's easier to sheet. So the opposite is the same. So I want a group from a group view model. And in this case, I'll call it to service model. And want to return this. So it's the same, but in the reverse order. Another nice thing that's useful is we want also to transform the collection, sorry. So we sometimes need to return the group view model in case of the we sometimes need to return a collection, so I read only collection. And we receive an I read only collection of groups. This is used, for instance, sorry, group. This is used in the get all method. So what we want to do here, again, we could use link, but as we are using a read-only collection, we know exactly the size of the collection. So we can do something like our groups equals new group view model array of models.length. And before that, we can just do this. If models.count equals 0, we can return array dot empty group view model. This is a good thing to do because if we return an array empty of something, instead of always being initializing a new collection, as an empty array is basically immutable, we can use every time the same instance. So we use less memory because we're always using the same instance. And like I said, because it's immutable, there's no problem, no one will change it. But if it's not zero, then we'll create an array and then do a for each models model, and then let me just put here var I equals 0. You can put groups indexed by the I equals model dot to view model and increment our counter. And then we could return directly the array, so return models, because an array is a not models groups because an array implements the I read only collection like this. We can see here by returning this, it was an I read only collection. But just to make sure no one touches this, unless with reflection you can do whatever you want, basically. We can do a new read-only collection and pass it groups. So this will be a bit more efficient than using link, just because we know the size and we allocate an array exactly of the size, and then we return it. We could just return that, but we use a wrapper because it's nicer. And now we can go back to our groups controller and from get all do to view model. Hopefully to view model. And no, what's missing? What did I miss? Mappings. No, this is missing. Okay, now we have it. Over here, it's basically the same. Now we have group service dot get by ID done. Now we have the group we to view model, and it's very readable, so it's nice. For the update, we can do it a bit differently. In this case, we won't be updating this like so we can just do this. Can just group service dot update and pass it the model dot to service model. We'll assume that the update returns null if we can't find that model, that entity. I'm not sure it's the best approach, but it works. So we can keep this like so. And over here, we no longer need this. We just do group service dot add model dot to service model. Okay, so it isn't really smaller because there wasn't really that much logic. But in this way, if we need in the future to put more logic in that. If we need to put more logic in the service, we can without having to touch this here. Let me check. Delete this and this. So the controller will be clean, just handling the responsibility of handling the requests and then pass it along to someone who knows how to handle them from the logic side. And that's about it. Now that we are using the interface, this won't work, of course, because we haven't created an implementation yet. Let's just check here the startup. Now we have this error because I deleted the demo. But over here, I will need to register the new implementation. So the group service, but we still don't have something to put here, so let's take care of that. Let's create a new project, which will be playball group management job business dot impl. Not the greatest names, but it will serve. We have two choices here, .NET Sender 2 and .NET Core App 2.1, because that's what I have installed. If I had more things installed, I could have more options, but .NET Standard. Okay. So we'll add a reference, hopefully. Add a reference. To business, because it's where the contracts are. And again, delete this default class. Add a directory to map to the same services. And we'll create a in-memory groups service. And it will implement a group service. So implement the methods. Okay. Okay. Now, what we need? It will basically have the same logic that was in the controller. Don't know why Rider adds this, but okay. So we'll need to have a list with the groups, call it groups, and start with it empty. And we need a current ID that will start with 0. Now, what do we need? We need a to return all. So in this case, we return groups. We could just return it like so, but we have this extension method, or this method of list, that makes it iReal only. But list also implements iReal only collection, so I could return it immediately. This is just to make it a wrapper. So get by ID. Again, the same as it was before, return groups.single or default, where the group ID equals the past ID. Now the update. We want to do this again. Okay, this can be called the same, of course. So I'll call to update if to update equals null, return null, we have nothing to update. We could also do an upsert, but in this case I'll just go with an update. And then to update dot name equals group.name, and we return to update just in case the application wants the entity that was updated. In case of the updated of the add, we just do groups.add group. Or better, we have to put group.id. Again, this is not the best approach, but of course, if we had a real database, this wouldn't be like so. And just return the group. As you see, this is not very good because, not being immutable, I'm just returning the same thing, changing it inside. It's not really that great, but for this demo purpose, it's more than good enough. When we have database, this will be cleaner. So we have an implementation. Hopefully that works. We'll see. So now we need to register this in dependency injection. So let's add a reference to the other project. And over here, we'll put in memory group service. No. Okay. This will continue to be singleton because if you noticed when I implemented, these are instance variables or instance fields. So if I add this transient in each request or even in request scope, it will be deleted and created a new one. So we want this singleton so it can survive. So let's see this in work. Server is running. If we refresh, we have an empty list because I didn't initialize anything. So new one, another one, and it works as before, with the difference that the logic is not on the controller but on a service. And all we did was put it here. Now let's take a look at slightly more interesting dependency injection stuff. If we notice, the add MVC is not doing an add singleton, add transient, add everything, anything. In reality, it is inside, but not here. Why is it like this? Because it's adding a lot of stuff, or some stuff at least. And if we needed to add everything over here, it wouldn't be good. So in this case, if we have more services and we just add them all over here, we will start to get this file really big with lots of things that could be better organized. Let's take a look, just because I downloaded the source code for ASP.NET, and let's look at add MVC. So we can see this has lots of things, lots of different adds again. Notice the add MVC core here. This is interesting because over here we could have done add MVC core instead of add MVC. And the difference is the things that are added. Add MVC core just adds the core services, like the name said. And add MVC adds more, so we can see that it uses the MVC core, but then adds Swagger stuff, authorization, views, Razor, stuff like that. If we want to make our application lighter, we could just use add MVC core and then add just the things we needed. I'll maybe do it in the future. In this case, not yet, because I'm using views and all that stuff. But maybe in the future, if we like doing an API, maybe I'll use MVC core and just add what we need, because we won't be neither Razor nor views when we are doing an API. But for now, we'll just go with add MVC. Now let's just look, for instance, at registering views. So again, it's adding more stuff, and if we continue to go into details, add, and now we can see the add enumerable, add singleton. Now it's adding really stuff. So all this to say what? We can do something of the same, with the same goal, to make it simpler here. So we could do something like services.addBusiness, for instance. So let's create here a new folder and do like IOC version of control. Let's call it service collection extensions. Not the best name, but it will work. Make it a static, and well, global static iService collection. Service collection, which is the interface that's used to register stuff, like we could see here, service collection. So let's get back here. Add business, and we'll receive again service iService collection services. Okay, and now we can do something like basically what's there. Maybe we get back here. Put this here. Okay. And now we return the same services, so we can change stuff. Another interesting thing to do is, instead of using this namespace, we can do this namespace, like so. And now when we go to the startup, we don't need to include anything. It's something Microsoft does to make it easier for discoverability. So we can just do this. Okay, so we add business. If we want more, we can add more services here and don't pollute our startup file. Let's see if this is still working. Seems to be. So refresh. It's empty because in memory was flushed. E1. And it's working. So nice. So far so good. Now let's look at something a bit more advanced regarding dependency injection. Until now we've been using the default dependency injection container that ships with ASP.NET Core. But it's a simpler container that serves the needs of the framework. It was developed for the framework, for in this case to register MVC require things and middleware stuff and all of that. But what if we want something more advanced that this dependency injection doesn't provide? Like we saw, this basically allows us to add the singleton, transient, and the request scope, maybe one or two more things, and not much else. So there are a lot of other dependency injection containers. A lot. They're even before Microsoft integrated it in ASP.NET, in this case ASP.NET Core, on the previous version of the ASP.NET, there wasn't a default one. So we had to use this, one of these. And there are basically two approaches. The one that Microsoft expects is for dependency injection containers implement this iService, not this iService collection, but the iService provider interface. Another approach that was taken, for instance, by the Simple Injector folks was not to do this, but do it in a different way. Today I'll go with the first approach because it's simpler to show, but in the future I may switch to Simple Injector because it has better performance than Autofact that I'll be using today. So let's make the changes required to use another dependency injection container. So this won't be used anymore. Not the way it is. Normally the things by Microsoft we still register in their iService collection that's provided. and then we do our registrations in another place. So let's use AutoFac. So I'll add a couple of packages. So we'll need AutoFac. And extensions dependency injection. Okay. Now let's go here. In Microsoft documentation for dependency injection, they show how we can replace. So if we look here, we get this is a void, we get the services, we register, all done. But if we want to replace it, it will now have to return an iService provider because this will be the service provider used instead of the default one. And we'll use AutoFac in this case, like exactly on the documentation, and do our AutoFac registrations on AutoFac, but then return the AutoFac service provider with its configurations. And in this case, the framework we'll now use instead of the default dependency injection container, we'll use AutoFac implementation of the iService provider. So let's just copy this to our application. Let's import what it needs. Let's change this to return an iService provider either. Okay, so we can override the default one. Here I'll call this AutoFac module, and this will be where we register our dependencies. So let's add it to the yoke I created earlier. Call it AutoFac module, and this is purely AutoFac code now, so it will depend on what applications you want. Let me just do another. I don't know this by heart, so we want this method. So this is where we'll register dependencies in the AutoFac container. In this case, we'll want to register exactly what we had here, so iGroup service, and in AutoFac this is done as I don't know this register type. Then in memory group service, but as I groups service and singleton instance. Okay, so this is the equivalent of what we did in the other way, in the other dependency injection container, but registering in AutoFac. But this will be different depending on the container you use. Now in the startup, this should be running right now, and it should work exactly how it was working. So server seems to be up, we can go here, refresh, and seems fine. New one, and it's persisted, so the singleton is working. Okay, so it's nice. But what we have so far is exactly the same as we already had. We didn't need to use AutoFac just for this. So let's complicate things a bit so it's useful to use a different dependency injection container. One example of a more advanced scenario that .NET Core's default dependency injection container doesn't provide is the using decorators. In an easy way to configure. So let's do just that. Now we'll do a decorator, I don't know for what. We'll just write to the console because that's what we can do with the things we talked about until now. So let's do a private class and we'll call it groups service decorator, and it will implement iGroup service. So a decorator basically decorates something, adding functionality or enriching in some way the what the end component does. So it implements in this case exactly the same interface, but we'll receive in the constructor we'll get an iGroups service. Let's call it inner. And pretty please, okay. So in the get all, we basically want to return inner.getAll. And just to do something with it, let's console.writeLine. Let me just add here so we can see it easier in the middle of all the logs. Okay. Let me just copy this to every method. I really don't know why writer does this. Group is not a reserved word. Oh, it is when we are using link, maybe. Okay, so in this case we want to return inner dot get by id. Return inner dot update group, and here return inner dot add group. Okay, so now we have our decorator. Now let's use it. This again is out of fact specific, but many other containers have this. We can do a register decorator and we want to register decorator. I think we should do this like this. And we use this. Okay, it's good for me. And now we do let me exactly new group service decorator and it will receive the service. And one thing we need to do is use here a string. There may be another way, but I didn't really look that up. But one way to do it is do something like group service, so it knows what it wants. In case we wanted more than one decorator, we will do like a chaining of decorators, each one referring to the previous name. So we want this, so we can do named okay, so this is being registered as a named, so group service, And then the decorator is saying that he wants that group service to be be passed here, and then we can pass it over here. So again, this should be working exactly as it was, but now writing to the console the new things. Let's refresh, and you can see hello from getAll. So we create, we see nothing because this operation didn't go into the service. Now if we create something new one, we see here getAll again because we are redirected to the home page, but hello from head, and we could go here and update. You can see update and then getAll. So the decorator is working and the logic is working because we could do everything and we didn't need to do anything out of this area. We didn't need to touch the group's controller, and in this case we didn't need to touch the startup class. So that's an example. There are many others and many other reasons you may want to use another dependency injection container. You may even not want more features, but just use a container with better performance. It's a possibility. Or you may want really more features and do it like this. It's a way to getting more features. So I think that's about it regarding this dependency injection episode. There are, of course, lots more things on dependency injection that we may talk about. Probably many of them we'll talk about in other episodes during different contexts. For instance, I just used the singleton lifecycle. The other lifecycles are very used, of course, as well. But in the way I was implementing this, I needed to use the singleton. But in the future, we will surely see the other ones. But for now, that's about it. Again, like in the previous episodes, any question, feel free to ask. And recommendations so I can improve the next episodes. Anyway, thanks for seeing you. Thanks for seeing this episode. And hope to see you again in the next one. See yous!